So, well, we started sensing the Lord was stirring us to leave in 2013, and it took a whole year of 2014 to basically leave Armenia because we were waiting for paperwork and things from the Spanish embassy in Toronto. We finally moved in December of 2014 and arrived just in time for the Christmas season and all of the hullabaloo. But the first thing we had to do was that we had to immediately apply for a residency card before we could get a bank account or internet or anything. We managed to get that application in, but it still took until the end of January to get. And then we finally got a bank account, and then we applied to get for internet, and that took 84 days from the time we arrived. And then we also had to wait for our container from Armenia, and there was a big delay in that. And instead of taking 40 days, it took 140 days to get to us. So we lived in an empty house with a plastic table, and some wooden IKEA chairs, and that's basically what we had for the first 4 months in Spain.
No laundry machine to use.
But the church here that we're working with, the Salem Church, has been excellent. They welcomed us right away. They've helped us through our transition. They provided a car for us for the first little while until we were able to get a vehicle here, and we're thankful for them. We finally felt like we connected in Spain and arrived probably about June for me and August for Kim, when we finally got our Spanish driver's licenses, which was a big obstacle. And so now we've been working on language, and we've been starting to do ministry in the church.
I was just going to add, I think it was the most stressful year we've ever had. And stressful in the sense that things were just really out of our control. We had no control over our container, no control over when it arrived, no control over our residency cards, none of that. And that just creates stress. And especially with the driver's test, no control over that. Even though we're experienced drivers, we had no say in taking the tests. But on the flip side of that, we really depended more on God and saw His faithfulness come through every time, and just leaning into Him in those moments where, Lord, I don't know how this is going to work, but I trust You in it.
Yeah, theological education is very important. It's important for churches as they develop and grow, so that they can develop key leaders who will fill positions in the church, or pastors who will give oversight and give vision. It helps the church to engage in evangelism and reaching unreached people around them. So really, theological education is about helping people to know what the Bible says and what we believe. It's also about helping them to be empowered with skills so that they can be effective in ministry. And it's really about helping people to develop character as well, so they are people of character and quality as they minister. As I travel around, and as I've taught in different places, so often I hear from students, thank you for teaching us this. You know, it's changed my perspective, or it's changed my life, or it's given me a new way of doing things that I had never thought of before. And that's very rewarding to hear. On the flip side of that, you know, we often encounter just errors and just bad teaching that people have. Just this past week, we were at a meeting, and there was a young guy, not from Spain, but from Latin America, and he was just sharing about some of his ideas about Jesus, and he shared four things, and all four things were incorrect, were just wrong, where he just did not have any understanding of Scripture. And I had to bring some correction to that, and I thought, you know, if there was training for guys like this, who he definitely wants to serve in ministry, but he just had no knowledge, I think he could be much more effective with good training. Here at the Salem Church, one of the pastors is Pedro David, and he is I'm working with him to develop the Bible school program. And even though he's a very capable teacher himself and has written a lot of home group materials for the churches here, he came to me a couple months ago and asked if I would meet with him every Friday to teach him the Bible, and so that he could learn from me, but also to give me an opportunity to practice my Spanish with him. So we meet for 2 to 2.5 hours every Friday. I stumble through my Spanish, and he's very patient with me, and I work through a scripture passage with him and teach him, and he told me this week when we met that this has become one of the highlights of his week, just getting together and growing and learning together. I appreciate this opportunity.
Sure. I really sort of in three parts. So the first part is helping people to come onto the field. And that in itself can be a huge adjustment. There's huge amounts of stress in leaving Canada, leaving your family, leaving everything you know, and coming to a brand new field. And then as soon as you get there, there's the stress of finding a place to live, the stress of learning the language, the stress of feeling like, oh my goodness, I can't even communicate. How am I ever supposed to survive here? And so helping families to adjust is a big part of that. And the second part of my role is really helping families that are already established on the field, and just making sure that they're fruitful, that they feel fulfilled, that they're working in the areas that God has gifted them in. But we find that a lot of the established missionaries, they go through all sorts of struggles of discouragement. There are spiritual battles. Many of them feel lonely and isolated because they don't have connection with other global workers or other foreigners who understand them. There's a lot of depression, especially among women. And I find too that in countries there are different strongholds, and each country has an area where people really struggle with, whether that's anger or, well, every country has its strongholds. And so helping families to become aware of that and to know how to deal with it in a healthy way. And then the third part of my role is really helping people to leave in a good way. Once they finish their term on the field, if they feel that's the end and God has a different season for them back in Canada or in another country, then helping them to leave well, to exit well, and to grieve in a good way, to deal with goodbyes and farewells, to make their relationships healthy, to reconcile, that's all part of member care as well. I should have mentioned too that even things, political situations like in Israel, making sure people are safe, or with the Paris attacks, making sure that they're okay. We have our global workers right there in Paris, making sure they know how to deal with safety issues. Or, you know, in Brussels, the same thing. So just making sure they feel supported and cared for.
That's a good question. I guess for me, for the whole family, we could use prayer for our language learning. We're progressing, we're getting along with it, but we still want to become even more fluent and more capable of language. So.
We really need to get up to teaching and preaching level. So.
Right, conversation level, but definitely have to move forward.
Okay.
And then?
Well, we're also in the middle right now of trying to renew our residence cards for Spain, and part of that means showing that our children are registered in a school, but we're homeschooling, and here in Spain it's just not well known, and so we really need a miracle. If you and your church could just pray that the Lord will help us to have favor with the government officials, so that we can homeschool. And it just, the homeschool is great because it gives us the flexibility to travel, and the kids can work at their own speed. And
they get a consistent education.
Yeah, it also provides a lot of consistency no matter where we live or whatever happens. At least there's some stability for them. So.
Hola Iglesia Heartland, los apreciamos mucho y gracias por tus oraciones. Por nosotros y Dios os bendiga grandemente. Adiós.